Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Andrew Stevens. I'm a faculty member here in Business Administration. And it's with great pleasure that I introduced you today to Dr. Sean Tucker, a friend and colleague here in Business Administration, associate professor. Sean teaches and researches in the area of occupational health and safety, and I would also consider him an advocate and an activist for these issues. I'm very excited about the talk because I've been hearing about it for months now. It would be great to turn a page and move somewhere else. But it's with great anticipation I've been hearing about this, and I think it'll be a very eye-opening experience and very illuminating when it comes to talking about safety and oil refining and the oil industry generally in the province. And for those of you who have been following the series, this is the final edition to a three-part installment titled How Safe is Oil Extraction, Transportation, and Refinement in Saskatchewan? And the title of Sean's talk is Safety at the Co-op Refinery Complex between 2006 and 2015. And I can assure you it will be a very comprehensive overview of the plant that leads us to the present situation and some of the events in the last decade. And just to give you a highlight of what the lecture series has talked about, overall it has examined safety in the oil extraction, transportation, and refining sectors in Saskatchewan. Speakers have provided a critical analysis of environmental, community, and occupational health and safety across the oil supply chain and identified gaps in the existing regulatory regimes. And I think what's been so important about the series is that together the presentations have provided a critical and timely examination of a topic that, in my opinion, receives very little scrutiny and needed attention in the province. We hear a lot about the boom. We don't hear about these day-to-day issues and the problems embedded within resource extraction. Part one was delivered by Dr. Emily Eaton in the Department of Geography, which focused on the safety of extraction, specifically oil and fracking. And part two is delivered by Dr. Simon Enoch, director of the Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives Saskatchewan office. And Simon is also an adjunct professor here at the University of Regina. And he focused at that time on the transportation of oil by rail and through pipelines. Joining Sean today, and it's a great pleasure to introduce Shana Stock, who will be adding a great deal of emotion and I think depth to this presentation. And Shana Stock is a poet who has been performing spoken word on local and national stages for the last 4 years. She has worked as an artist in residence at the Creative City Center, Generating Momentum Youth Leadership Camp, and the Saskatchewan Federation of Labor's Human Rights Conference. Shana regularly works with organizations and groups to develop and perform collaborative poetry and loves finding new ways to make art accessible and available to all. I will remind the audience that today's talk is recorded, as you can see from the cameras at the back. Our plan is to make publicly accessible Sean's talk as well as those that preceded it. We're just struggling to find a venue, but it should be available as a URL in the next few weeks, so you'll be able to access that online and share it. When we come to the question and answer periods, the cameras will be turned off and we can speak freely, and that component of the talk will not be recorded. So please join me in welcoming Sean and Shana.
Thanks, Andrew, and thanks everyone for coming today. We tried to get a larger venue yesterday, but all the rooms are filled on campus, so we're stuck with this venue. Apologies to people standing at the back. The purpose of this talk is to provide an assessment of the safety culture at the Co-op Refinery Complex over the last 10 years. I've got a lot of ground to cover today. So I'm going to move fairly quickly through some segments of the presentation. As Andrew said, the slides will be posted and the video recording will be available online on YouTube as soon as it's ready. This research is ongoing. I'm still conducting interviews, collecting data, and I'll present an update on the findings at a later date. A couple disclosures at the beginning. One, I'm a faculty member here, as Andrew said, but I do consulting for the Workers' Compensation Board in Saskatchewan on their injury prevention side. I don't have any involvement in their policy side. And second, I am undertaking a online survey, and it's a partnership with the Ministry of Labor Relations and Workplace Safety. So just a couple of disclosures there. List of people to thank here. In particular, the journalists in the room who have covered the Co-op Refinery over the past few years. I think done some good work there. The largest, very large employer in the city, and not easy work to do. Very quickly through the sources for my research. Mariah, my research assistant who's in the room, collected about 300 pages of print and television stories on the refinery, court documents related to 2011 explosion, investigative reports, some which required a written request of the court to get access to victim impact statements, Federated Co-op Limited, annual reports and other information on their website, interviews, they're ongoing now. In terms of the interviews, I've to date put out 13 requests. Three have participated, they're listed at the bottom. Two have committed to participate in the future, two have declined, and six I've received no response to date. I won't go into depth about the research ethics, but participation in interview is voluntary, and people are free to decline without any consequence to them. They can withdraw from the research at any time. I can tell you that, and I've had conversations with the chair of my research ethics board here and Federated Co-op here, that Federated Co-op has declined to participate in the research, and they provided a written statement, which they said I could read if I wanted to, and so I'll read this statement. I invited Mr. Vic Heward, Executive Vice President of Strategy at Federated Co-op. I invited Scott Banda, the CEO of the Federated Co-op, to interview, and also the head of the refinery, Gilles Ledresse, to interview, declined, and this is the note from Vic Heward. We take safety, culture, and accountability very seriously at the refinery, and we are focused on improvements in that regard at all times. That said, it is a matter of public record that there have been some safety incidents at the refinery. Federated Co-op has cooperated fully with investigations into these incidents conducted by a number of agencies and experts, including, but not limited to, the Regina Fire Department, TSASC, Occupational Health and Safety Division, and a number of third-party laboratories and engineering experts. The findings of these various investigations have informed continuous improvement initiatives at the refinery. In addition, the refinery has engaged the services of a number of internationally well-respected consultancies, including DuPont, Hitachi, and Pilco, to provide support to a number of major initiatives intended to enhance our process and personal safety protocols. In light of these initiatives, and with all due respect, we do not feel that participation in your project will add any insight or value to our continued efforts to improve safety culture at the refinery, and we respectfully decline invitation to participate. I also said I would send written questions to them, and they declined that as well. In providing an assessment of safety culture at an organization, it involves analysis of quotes and statements from top organizational leaders. So I want to acknowledge the source of these quotes up front. So Scott Banda, CEO of Federated Co-op Limited, Vic Heward is Vice President of Strategy. Bud Van Eijderstein is the former VP of Operations at the refinery. And Gilles Ledresse is the VP of Operations at the refinery today. Federated Co-op Limited. So this is the parent company to the refinery. The refinery, the consumers, Co-op Refinery Complex is a wholly owned subsidiary of Federated Co-op, and the Federated Co-op has 10 business units: grocery, agriculture, and energy. And the refinery fits under energy. The refinery employs just over 1,000 people now. I'm not sure if everybody's represented by Unifor Local 594, but many are. It's the only cooperative-owned refinery in the world. Federated Co-op is a big company on the Financial Post rankings. It ranks 38th in Canada for profits. And it's first overall in Saskatchewan in terms of revenue at $10.8 billion. Federated Co-op has undergone aggressive expansion in recent years, and that's trickled down to the refinery. The petroleum retailing system is vast, stretches from Vancouver Island, Peninsula Co-op, to places close to home, Sherwood Co-op, and into Manitoba and Northern Ontario. The refining capacity has grown from 55,000 barrels per day in 1998 to 130,000, with a potential capacity of 145,000 today, which marks a 140% increase in just 16 years. In 2012-13, a new section opened up to the refinery, Section 5, and this is noteworthy. I'm going to flag this now because I'm going to come back to it later in the presentation. Major expansion funded by Federated Co-op, projected to cost $1.9 billion in the end, and it cost $2.7 billion, so $800 million over budget, or 42% over budget. So a major expansion that occurred right around the time these safety incidents happened. The annual financial statements for Federated Co-op do not provide separate financials for the refinery itself. They're lumped together in their energy business unit, so it includes refining, manufacturing, distribution, these sorts of things of petroleum products. What I found surprising when I first began working on this was that the large percentage of both revenue and net income that came from the energy business of Federated Co-op. So about 78% of net income is from the energy business. And the refinery is a linchpin in that business. Someone recently remarked to me that the grocery business was a front for the Federated Co-op's petroleum interests. But anyway, it's a big part of Federated Co-op, a very large part of the business. In terms of corporate histories, you can find them online, co-op refinery website there, and then there was a special advertising section, Leader Post, this past summer. The story there is of struggle against all odds, of farmers banding together and overcoming adversity and creating their own co-op in the refinery in the mid-1930s and expanding over time. The expansion's been tied to economic development in the province. Here you see a picture of Premier Douglas at an event. There's some large expansions in the 60s, and it was billed as the largest public event where they had like 40,000 people come out for the opening of the new section of the refinery. There's the location of the refinery. Residential development is kind of encroached on the refinery back in the day. I mean, it was on its own outside, but it's in the city limits with residential close by. Here's a bit of a, this is the latest picture I get off Google Earth, but it doesn't show all of Section 5, I don't think built, but you can see Section 5 is out here. And And again, the history of the refinery very much tied it around, at least stated, espoused around cooperative values and hope and promise. And so that's a quote from the website there. In terms of refineries in Canada, there are about 15 to 17, depend how you count them, in Canada of various size. The co-op refinery at its current capacity ranks sixth of refineries in Canada. It does have, with the Section 5 expansion, the capacity for 145,000 barrels a day, which would put it up to fourth largest refinery in Canada. I'm going to shift now to safety in the refinery, and my area of expertise is safety culture, safety climate, and I'm not a petroleum engineer. I just want to declare that right off the bat. Safety culture climate is really the priority that top management, that a frontline supervisor puts on safety relative to other priorities, whether it be production, cost cutting, productivity, what have you. And so this is the central concept in my research and for my talk here. I'm interested in looking at the alignment between the espoused priority of safety that the organizational leadership that has for safety and what's actually enacted on the front lines. Okay? I look very closely, examine closely the comments of top leaders in organizations and compare those to frontline employees, other evidence of safety, and look for alignment or gaps between comments and what's actually happening on the front lines. Oil refineries, it's a dangerous business. When there's proper process safety, proper maintenance, they run well and there aren't any incidents. But sometimes, due to a poor safety culture, incidents occur. Most notably, here's one in Texas City. Refinery explosion 2005, 15 workers killed, 170 injured. The regulator's investigation identified cost cutting, lack of training, and poor inspections as underlying causes of this incident. This is a BP installation. Of course, a few years later, we have Deepwater Horizon that occurred again, another major incident in the US. And BP, it's well documented, had a cultural problem. As part of the research, I spoke to people in the U.S. I've got a couple follow-up calls to make with my contacts in the U.S. I also spoke to somebody with steelworkers at the North Atlantic refinery, or the Come By Chance refinery in Newfoundland, Perry Feltham. And a nice long chat about various aspects of refining safety in general. Perry wasn't familiar with the co-op refinery, didn't make any comments on what our experiences were in Regina. I will say he was concerned, and he actually offered at the end of the interview to come to Regina and speak to people about their experience in their local about building up a culture of safety. Perry mentioned, you know, we all know it's dangerous business. And you're not boiling, when you're boiling oil, you're not boiling milk. And, you know, simply put, you want to keep all your product and all your fuel inside the piping, not outside. If you get vapors outside, vapor clouds, and a source of ignition, you know what you got. Kaboom. And one of the elements of refining safety that he highlighted was corrosion on pipes. Anytime you got an older refinery with insulation on pipes, you got an opportunity for moisture under insulation and corrosion of pipes. You get corrosion on pipes, you get potential for leaks, you get vapor clouds that come out, and with an ignition source, you get explosions, okay? So preventative maintenance, really key there. Perry also, as a VP of the Steelworkers Local, and he's on their investigative joint management union investigation committee when incidents do occur, stress that it's important for the union and its members to put safety first, okay? He did mention that employees can be afraid of rocking the boat. They're usually quite well paid, and some are hesitant employees, even some union officials are hesitant to raise concerns for fear of possible shutdown. But he felt strongly that unions need to have safety at the fore always. There aren't, I could not find in my research any data on the number of incidents at refineries across Canada. Main reason for that, I think, is that it's a provincially regulated industry, and so there's some variation in regulation there. The president of the Canadian Fuels Association, which represents most refineries in Canada, says that safety is never compromised. If it can't be done safely, our members won't do it. We take safety seriously, and we have excellent track record to prove it. No one should get hurt on or off the site. I couldn't find any information on their website about the number of fires, explosions, other incidents that's member refineries, though. So again, my focus is on safety at the consumer, cooperative refinery complex between 2006 and 2015, but I did have a look at incidents before this, and these were just incidents that were flagged in recent reporting on the incidents at the refinery. So you can't actually do a search of the leader post back into the 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s. You'd have to go into the microfiche and look at it all manually. So these are just flagged, but there have been incidents in the past. Here's one here, individual working at the refinery in 1969, dies of third degree burns, a storage tank exploded there. 1985 to 1988 is the upgrader expansion at the refinery. A lot of discussion about that here, and positive statements about the contribution of the upgrader to Saskatchewan's economic future. So the president of Federated Co-op says that the refinery towers and the sod we're turning today for the upgrader are symbols of hope. Premier at the time, Mr. Grant Devine, says this is a visionary project, is part of the new economic foundation on which we'll build jobs and opportunity for Saskatchewan residents far into the future. There are a number of problems with the upgrader construction and operation. It's over budget. There's operational problems. So quote, it was a joint effort, New Grade and the co-op was operating this upgrader. But the head of this said, you have to remember, this is the first heavy oil upgrader in Canada, and so there is no experience in operating a beast of this size. And they run into all sorts of issues. These are quotes here from newspaper reporting on February 27th, 1989, we get gas wafting over Regina School. Readings are 50 times higher than provincial air quality standards allow. March 28th, an oily plume settles on cars and houses. There's claims for damage from that. There's a fire on April 2nd. There's sulfur catches on fire in May. And then there's an explosion on August 27th, 1989. And so this is some snapshots from the the Leader Post, the Time. Nearby businesses want alarm system. So we see during this period of rapid expansion that there's incidents, right? And you know, causes are probably all different, but it's still a time of expansion, and we see this with the expansion of the refinery in recent years. Whole bunch of issues. Fast forward 1 year, there's another fire at the refinery. 2001 fire and heat exchanger unit, and a small fire in 03. Okay, about 2000 on, I'm able to search the Leader Post with keywords. There's digitized papers there. 2004, there's a fire caused by lightning hitting the refinery, and So I think that's the only time that's happened. Bud says it's time. There's possibility the thing could have gotten bigger, but fortunately not. 2004, there's a gas leak noted in a Regina a Leader Post story. Bud says, I would not say that this became a very serious incident, although it did have potential to become more serious, particularly if we had ignition of the gases. So I'm going to shift now to the main part of the presentation. That's focusing on the safety culture at the refinery 2006-2015. And I want to begin with some statements made by senior managers at Federated Co-op and also the refinery in terms of the relative importance of safety at the refinery. And then I'm going to shift to looking at the reality on the ground and what those same organizational leaders were saying during and after the recent incidents, safety incidents at the refinery. So a story from in the Leader Post from 2007, which a group of residents were told that the co-op, co-op refinery not only complies with all environmental and safety standards, but wants to go further and be, quote, more than in compliance. In 2010, in a story Leader Post, those principles, there are four core principles: safety, equipment integrity, environmental stewardship, and quality in all products and services take priority to everything. We don't compromise those principles. Shifting forward to this year, but a comment about sort of the historical importance of safety at the refinery. This comes from the manager of safety and security at the co-op refinery. It stated that the safety program at the complex began to really take off about 25 years ago. And I take that to mean after the upgrader went in and they had all those issues. At the same time, the OH&S movement was gaining momentum in the province. Since then, we've just been building it one brick at a time, keeping up with industry best practices and always striving to exceed expectations. And then finally, one quote from Scott Banda, the CEO of Federated Co-op, from this past May. Our culture of safety is top-notch and we work to improve it all the time. We have an 80-year history in this city, and over those 80 years, I would put our record up against anyone in the industry. So that's the in terms of espousals about the priority of safety. This is, I think, fairly represents what safety, how important safety is. What's being said. We'll go into other comments after incidents that have occurred the past 5 years, but this sort of historical perspective and the relative priority of safety, very important. Refinery. One of the key documents I look at in terms of an indicator of safety is annual reports. And I looked at all the annual reports posted on Federated Co-op's website that go back to 2009. And in these annual reports, they have a section for the refinery and the other business units. When you look at the 2009-2010 reports, safety isn't mentioned in one of the reports in the refinery section of the report, not even mentioned. Okay, all it says, 2009, Consumers Co-op Refinery Limited's mission is to serve the cooperative retailing system providing petroleum product supply. They talk about a lot of focus on operational output expansion and meeting environmental needs, but process safety not even mentioned. 2011-12, these are after the October 2011 explosion. The language is shifting here. The management of the co-op refinery complex is totally committed to the four core principles that are always to take priority over production. These protection principles in order of priority are to ensure safety, equipment integrity, environmental stewardship, and quality of product and service. Okay. Somewhere around, I think, I don't have an exact date, but I think it's around 2008, DuPont is brought in as a consultant to develop, enhance, or put in place a process safety management system. It's noted in the 2011 annual report. 2013, the language is shifting a little bit here. Co-op Refinery provides quality products and service to ensure safety, high reliability through equipment integrity and environmental soundness. 2013 report mentions in the past 3 years, Refinery has been enhancing a comprehensive process safety management system to target safety initiatives and manage operational risks throughout independent consultation. The system's implementation phase has begun and will continue over the next few years. What I find interesting about this quote is it talks about enhancing a comprehensive system, and then it talks about implementing something. So I'm not sure if what system was in place, what's being enhanced, what is new. It's a bit unclear from the statement. Today, the refinery from the new website, they want to be recognized as a leader in safety, reliability, and sustainability within the petroleum refining industry. Okay, so to see a shift over time, back to 09, safety is not even mentioned today, you're talking about being a leader. Okay. And they note in the 2014 report that they're continuing to implement a comprehensive process safety management system. I don't know when that started, what they had before that, where they're at now. It's not clear. So that's a very quick run through of the espoused priority on safety and where we've been since 2006 onward, based on available evidence that I had access to. Now, there have been a rash of incidents at the refinery since 2011. These just represent what's been reported. I'm going to speak to each incident individually and spend the most time on the October 6, 2011 explosion. This incident alone could be a 3-hour lecture. There's a lot to unpack there. I'm going to go as quickly as I can through it in the interest of time. But there's a lot in there. I'm going to speak to fatalities. You notice there's two fatalities on here, one in 2007, one 2014. These haven't been reported in the media. I'll speak to those after the September 10th, 2015 incident. Where I want to start with these incidents is a report that, before that, the question becomes is how does the co-op refinery compare to other refineries in Canada? And because of differences in reporting fires and leaks and that, and some go unreported in Canada, there's just no central database to collect that information, and I just simply could not collect that information. It's one of the interesting things with our federation is the provincial jurisdiction and that. So I can't do a comparison on those types of incidents. Explosions are different, I think. Explosions, it's hard for them not to be reported in the media. So what I did is I searched one of our databases through our library for explosion in each refinery name. And over this 10-year period, I found that the Co-op Refinery was the only refinery to have two explosions. There are four other refineries that had one explosion over that time. So clearly there's a problem here. I mean, we've had more explosions and more injuries as a result of explosions than any other refinery in Canada in the last 10 years. The next slide is important, and I have to thank Jeff Leo, who's here in the front, for on covering this here. This is a report, a table from a report put out by the Canadian Fuels Association in July 2012. And it's got confidential written on it. I don't know why it's posted on the Canadian Fuels Association website, but it says confidential. But it was for the refineries, and it looked at their emissions and did a comparison. And it flagged the co-op refinery for emission of volatile organic compounds. It noted here, it's kind of hard to read this, but this is quite a bit higher than any other refinery in Canada. And it, the report noted, this is an industry report, noted that one refinery required reductions in VOC emissions. VOC reductions are typically handled by implementing a leak detection and repair program and retrofitting existing tanks with internal floating roofs. All right, the data here is from 2010. Okay, the point I want to make here is that this report, it would seem to indicate that the refinery knew or ought to have known that they had issues with VOCs early on from an industry report. Now, Jeff followed up on this in June of this year and interviewed a researcher at University of Calgary who said the fugitive emissions can be very high if the plant is poorly run or poorly maintained, or if it is a very old plant with corroding pipes, leaking valves, leaking joints, and so on. Okay. Note, it can be. The person not commenting on the co-op refinery, just making a statement. This is one possibility. All right. The communications director at the refinery responded by saying, "We have budgeted and are proceeding with bringing the leak detection and repair system to our facility." This is in 2015. And they knew, you know, a while ago about it. Don't know why that wouldn't have been done. There may be a good reason for it, but a lot of their problems seem to be related to leaks. And we're going to hear about the victim impact statements, a discussion of leaks. And here was an industry report that cited that, and nothing's been done until 2015. I don't know why that is. So we'll start with the 2006 explosion. This was caught on security camera, and it won't load all of a sudden. Well, that's, let me just see if I can do that here quickly. Okay. And what's going on here? You can see it. And it does not want to do this for me. Go figure. There it goes. Okay. Actually, multiple explosions occurring. Very large explosion. Okay. And 52 workers were injured in here of varying severity, some with just very, very minor smoke inhalation, these things. Most of the injured workers were working for a scaffolding company called Sky High Canada. The total estimated cost and damages and lost production was $100 million from this explosion. I'll just turn it over to Shana to read some of eyewitness accounts of the explosion that you just saw.
The French language high school Laval is just 1 kilometer from the co-op refinery that exploded on Thursday, and many of its students witnessed the inferno while on break from classes. "It was like a loud bang," said one student. "We saw smoke. There was a little black mushroom cloud," said another. Diane Illingworth described a scene that met her as she arrived at her Uplands home, adjacent to the ring road and across from the refinery. "You could see a lot of flames shooting into the sky," she said, adding that several people had gathered at the end of the usually quiet cul-de-sac to watch. "It was scary. It was so close. You know, there are a lot of chemicals at the refinery," she said. Illingworth, glad the wind was carrying the smoke away from her neighborhood, wondered how bad it would get before area residents needed to evacuate. "I'm glad to see it out," she said, as the smoke dissipated, adding that she's never been overly worried about the area's proximity to the refinery. "You can't be afraid of these things." Denise, who declined to give her last name, is a longtime resident of the Uplands area. She spotted the thick black smoke and bright orange flames from her kitchen window. "I thought, oh my God, it's not a good thing to start on fire," she said. Denise watched water pouring onto the flames from aerial trucks. She too wondered if someone would be knocking on her door to evacuate. "It kind of scares you," she admitted, but quickly added that she grew up in the area, and so it's home. 3. Devin, an apprentice at the co-op refinery, was just 40 feet from the explosion that rocked the compound Thursday afternoon. "Everyone was so terrified, you just heard people say, 'Go, go, 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 get out of here,'" and said Devin, who was just east of the compound at the time of the explosion. He said the first explosion shook the ground. The second bang jolted Devin, and he took off running for his life. He said everyone around him was sprinting for the gate, calling it hectic. "You could just see guys on scaffold trying to get down as quickly as they can. There was a big flame about 250 feet in the air. That's a little scary for the guys on the scaffold," he said.
Okay. And some workers were seriously injured with burns, broken bones, serious smoke inhalation. They continue to struggle with the physical injuries and long-term psychological injuries such as post-traumatic stress disorder and related symptoms, nightmare, depression, flashbacks, panic attacks, and headaches. There are several victim impact statements on file with the court. I went through them. Just people devastated by this. And the psychological impact has been great for many people. And Shana will share with you one account from an injured worker.
So this is a victim impact statement from Irene Rombout, read in court on May 12, 2015. "The thing I remember most about the explosion on October 6, 2011 is the fear in people's eyes. I could see it in my coworker Shane as he encouraged me to run, and also the first aid attendant who was trying to cool down my burns. The sounds I keep hearing from that day are the moans of Sean Farrell, who was lying hurt on the ground, and the alarms which seemed faint compared to the screaming and the yelling of other employees. What I felt was unendurable pain on my face and arms, and the burning in my chest, as well as numbness or disbelief of what was going on. The first I remember when I woke up in the hospital was my daughter holding my hand and crying, telling me not to die. The injuries I sustained were second-degree burns to my face, ears, neck, both wrists, bilateral flanks, right shoulder extending from the top of the shoulder to the elbow, a few spots on my back, lips, inside of my mouth, throat, and lungs, as well as a partially dislocated shoulder. The co-op refinery failed us. They did not ensure our safety. We have physical and emotional scars to show that."
And so there are 12 victim impact statements that were given in January of this year. Three of them were read into the court record, and that's Shane is sharing information from those that read in the court record. Those victim impact statements makes some pretty serious allegations about safety at the refinery in the lead up to the 2011 explosion. I was in court in May when during the sentencing hearing when these were read in, and I was quite surprised as an occupational health and safety researcher that things seem, and these have not been proven in court, I should mention, seem quite bad at the refinery. Victim impact statements refer to frequent alarms, sometimes several times a day. There's a couple people that mention alarms on the day of the explosion, even moving alarms on the day of the explosion. Disconnected alarms, alarms with rag stuff in them. The smell of gas. Several people note complaints, some in writing. They say were ignored at regulated occupational health and safety meetings. One person who's a foreman noted a significant hydrogen leak months prior to the explosion. More than one mentioned that they were said they could, if they raised these concerns, they didn't like safety, they could pick up their tools and go home. And some mentioned that the training was not what they were used to working in the industry previous to that. So Shana will read one victim impact statement that deals with these issues in the refinery.
And this one is by Sean Farrell, read in court on May 12, 2015. I went to work with Consumers Co-op Gas Refinery Limited on October 3rd, 2010, after I was dispatched from my union local, from my union hall local 1325 Carpenters Union, Edmonton, Alberta. I was working as a subcontracted foreman with Sky High Canada as a full-time temporary foreman. It was supposed to be a 2+ year project. I had worked in the oil and gas industry for over 20 years at the time of the explosion. With respect to my feelings about safety and my time working with co-op, I can say that I have felt less safe with their procedures and protocols as compared to other companies. Starting from my orientation, which incidentally was much shorter than other companies I worked with, 6 hours compared to 2 or 3 days, I felt that topics were skimmed over. I asked questions that other junior employees told me afterwards they were glad I had brought up, as they did not feel comfortable with the limited information they were being provided. We were allowed to listen to safety alarms, which interestingly we discovered later that these alarms were not able to be heard in the area where the explosion occurred, and mobile alarms were put in place, referred to as rig rats, and these were often disconnected and or had rags stuffed inside to mute the sound because they were going off so frequently. With respect to safety at specific places of employ, the union did not express concern or defend the employers, as they were only interested in posting jobs and filling them as required. In retrospect, I noticed safety concerns for months prior to the explosion. I had heard many stories and witnessed things that made no sense to me. Concerns were presented in weekly safety meetings. Complaints were put in writing and given to the Occupational Health and Safety Committee, but nothing was ever done. One of the main concerns presented to co-op management during weekly safety meetings was the inability to hear the alarms in the area of the explosion. The response that was received from the employer representative was to use the buddy system, which essentially meant a coworker would verbalize a concern about a potential hazard, or to use a clack horn, which is a handheld air horn which can be activated by pressing a button if a hazard was noted. This same company representative informed me and other employees present that if we did not like their safety system, we could pick up our tools and go home, as no changes to safety protocols would be made. I was shocked when I heard this, but I felt that I had no choice and had to stop worrying and continue doing my job. On many occasions, I witnessed an operator standing on a catwalk in the area of the explosion, using a personal gas monitor to measure gas levels in open areas where we were working. He had it secured on the end of a long stick and would extend it in front of him as he walked around our working areas. This instrument was meant for an individual to measure gas levels in his or her personal working space. We were told that he was looking for a gas leak and that there was nothing for us to worry about. Frequently, as often as 3 to 4 times a day, alarms that indicated a potential gas leak caused us to be evacuated to muster stations, only to be sent back to work after 10 to 15 minutes when a headcount was completed. There was a significant hydrogen leak in the area of the explosion just months prior to the October 4th, 2011 event. I could go on at many other examples to give you an idea about the incidents that indicated that things were not safe at this gas plant, but I think you get the idea, which just adds to my frustration and anger about how this company did not have any regard for our safety or lives in general. It is my belief that what happened to me and my coworkers was not an accident, but the natural consequence of human negligence because of bad decisions by my employer when they were given ample information of the problems in advance of this terrible explosion. I am not exaggerating or presenting any false information. I just want you to realize that real people are being hurt by the companies they represent when these companies believe that they are above the law and their greedy desires are more important than providing a safe work environment.
Thank you, Shana. So it provides some insight into experiences on the front line in this particular area of the refinery in the lead up to the explosion. Again, the allegations have not been in court, and I'll get into the court case in a few moments to explain why. Other people mention brittle pipes in the refinery here. They're old and corroded. 6 days after the explosion on October 12th, Scott Banda sent this handwritten note. This was submitted by the co-op defense lawyer in court in May at the sentencing hearing. Expresses concern and remorse for what happened at the refinery. And I want to flag this one quote here. Banda says, "We do place the safety of our workers and the public ahead of everything we do at the refinery. When despite our best efforts, people are injured, we will use every effort to find out what happened and take whatever steps we can to ensure nothing like it happens again." And I want you to remember that quote when we get on to the Christmas Eve explosion, because something happened that could be prevented. That incident could have been prevented. The Federated Co-op and refinery response to the explosion was swift. They said that since the incident, the refinery has been conducting a comprehensive safety review with an external consulting firm. We're well into that process and we'll continue with that process. This is a key part here. I want you to remember this one here as we move through the presentation. We're looking at all aspects of our process and maintenance, as we do all the time, but this is a very deep dive for us. So that's what they said on October 15th, 2011. We're going to have a deep dive into their safety system. Next summer in August, they committed to 19 actions, including written procedures that outline how pipe wall thickness monitoring locations are determined and actions related to inspections, okay? Just, I think, weeks after the explosion, Mr. Bandra provides an address to other co-ops and mentions the explosion at the refinery, but also discusses financial performance in this talk. And we don't have time to review this, but I would say it's interesting read when you're looking at culture and relative priorities. There's a lot of emphasis on financial performance at Federated Co-op. And you remember, it's looking like they're $800 million over budget on their expansion. What were the discussions around the board table at Federated Co-op then? Were they about safety or were they about expansion, financial priorities? Don't know, but you can watch that and draw your own conclusions. On August 20th, 2013, the Ministry of Justice lays 5 charges under the Occupational Health and Safety Act for the 2011 explosion. January of this year, the refinery pleads guilty to 1 charge, its failure to ensure that all work at a place of employment was sufficiently and competently supervised. The we don't have time to go into the investigation reports. I'm going to post them online. If you're interested in the details, they'll be there. Essentially, you have a pipe here that blew out. It was corroded and thinned, quite thin, actually, vapor and ignited. There were two investigation reports into the 2011 explosion. One was commissioned by the Regina Fire Service, came out on May 7th. It's known as the Anderson and Associates report. I have a question there. Is who paid for this ultimately? The city, I think, and the fire paid for it, but was it ultimately paid by the refinery? Still an open question there. After this one came out, the refinery commissioned their own report, the exponent report. They paid for this report. It came out last fall, and it's critical of the Anderson and Associates report. It drives at different conclusions, the purpose of this is it could be for insurance purposes or as a defense document. Okay, the independent report is the Anderson Associate. This is the exponent report. There was no rebuttal to the exponent report. The exponent report is not publicly available yet. You can write to the court as I did and get a copy, but you had to sign a waiver saying it's proprietary information there, can't release in public. I'm going to ask Federated Co-op if we can release it, but I don't know what they'll say. So here's the pipe. This is just a picture of the pipe down in section B here, and it's quite thin here, well below standards. The sentencing hearing, because there was a plea, there was also, in this case, an agreed statement of facts between the Crown and defense. I am, in the interest of time, I cannot read all the agreed statement of facts. I'm going to provide 6 points for context here. I'd encourage people to read the entire agreed statement of facts. I'm going to post the court transcript. It'll be there. So why did this happen in 2011? There's a disagreement on it, but here's some points they agree on. In 2008, there was changes in the refining process, which led to an accelerated corrosion rate in the reactor effluent line, which is that line that you saw that was ruptured. The exponent report asserts that the wrong pipe was initially installed, a schedule 40 as opposed to an 80, 40 being a thinner pipe. The refinery was responsible for supervising the initial installation of the pipe and for ensuring the proper schedule pipe was installed throughout the facility. Some pipe inspection was conducted by the refinery in 2010, leading to the replacement of certain portion of the pipe in the real but not the ruptured section, based in part on ultra pipe data, which is a monitoring system they use at the refinery. The refinery relied on the judgment and training of the inspector to evaluate whether additional inspection of the line was required. Additional inspection was performed in 2010 at the time of pipe replacement to determine the extent of the accelerated corrosion. Last point from the agreed statement of facts. As part of the documents provided to Anderson Associates, there was a PowerPoint presentation summarizing the refinery's piping inspection program. That document stated a basic assumption with the UltraPipe software, this is the monitoring software for corrosion and thickness, is that the corrosion rate or deterioration mechanism is relatively constant in a given piping circuit. And this is the key part here. When we find serious corrosion issues with the circuit, we try to determine the cause of the corrosion and expand the survey to the thinnest location. The Crown argued they didn't do that. They didn't follow their own procedure. This is not time to go into detail here. You can read these, will be posted here. The Anderson report, they note several deficiencies. They say it's, you know, for example, obvious from our review that of the refinery's inspection plan, they were not following their own guidelines. They didn't, appears that this informal inspection plan is not adhered to it rigorously. So there's some issues they raise there. The exponent report comes to a different conclusion. It says, without the benefit of hindsight, the refinery could not reasonably be expected to find the pipe spool that ruptured, which originally had schedule 40 wall thickness rather than schedule 80, with an inspection program based on predicted damage mechanisms. So they say, Anderson says, there were lapses here in monitoring in this thing. The exponent report paid for by the refinery sharply disagrees with the Anderson report on several points and also says, without the benefit of hindsight, we couldn't have seen this was going to happen. In court in May, the Crown Counsel argues, says, look, the TML stands for thickness monitoring location, and they're just sensors along the pipes. When you look at the column of values, he's referring to a table in the reports, for this sensor at 13, in 2004, the value of thickness is 0.38. In 2010, 6 years later, the value is still 0.38, despite the company being aware of this accelerated corrosion in that pipe. And so looking at all those things together, the conflict between the data and the visual inspection, the fact that despite accelerated corrosion, there does not appear to be any decrease in monitoring data over a six-year span. Does this fulfill the company's obligation to properly supervise the work at its plant? Furthermore, so the company has pled to this failing to supervise what's happening in its plant. We know from the expert reports that a much thinner section of pipe was present at the ruptured location. We know that the company was aware of accelerated corrosion in its pipes. And in the Crown's estimation, it's painfully obvious to anyone looking at the data that something's up. You replaced a section, it was corroded, it was visually a thing, your sensors aren't giving you data that's consistent with the visual inspection. You should have gone further, and you didn't follow your own pipe inspection plan in the PowerPoint presentation. The defense has a different conclusion. They say, look it. The wrong pipe was installed in 1961. That's our failure to supervise. We didn't supervise properly when that section was being built in 1961. In Robert Gates, the defense lawyer, says, this is not a recent default. This is a continuing default. This is something that happened a long time ago. Scott Banda says to the media, the charges it relates to us was failure to supervise in 1961. Someone in 1961 simply, unfortunately, regrettably, picked up the wrong piece of pipe and put it in that run. The judge in the case provides no written decision. The best we have is the transcript of the sentencing hearing. And I think it's interesting here that the judge is acknowledging both, I think he's acknowledging both that the wrong pipe was installed, but monitoring was required. Says, he also says that, I appreciate what you're saying. He's talking to the defense lawyer, that there's a degree of fault here, that this is not a company that has egregiously or flagrantly ignored safety. But nonetheless, there was something that was a mistake in 1960 or 61 that eventually ruptured, and better monitoring might have detected it. And there's an admission of fault to that extent. I think what I find interesting about this is that the Federated Co-op and Refinery stick to this story, that it was just the wrong pipe was put in, when the Crown, the Anderson Associates, even the judge is saying, like, monitoring is important too. So I'm not sure they're taking full responsibility for what happened in 2011. A surprising statement. I couldn't believe this. I was sitting in the courtroom. The defense, at the sentencing hearing, the defense lawyer says that the refinery paid the cost of the investigation by the regulator, Occupational Health and Safety, who had no budget for this. And they immediately stepped up to the plate and said, we'll pay that. And they paid all the engineering, and they wanted their own study, so they hired Exponent. I mean, it's like an unbelievable statement to make, basically saying the regulator's broke and we're going to come in and save the day after we've had a major explosion at our place. So I followed up with the deputy minister at Ministry of Labor Relations and Workplace Safety, Mike Carr, about this statement. And Mike said the statement is incorrect and self-serving, both in its tone and tenor. Further, this commentary, I believe, was an attempt by Mr. Gates to cast his client, the refinery, in the best possible light. Its sentencing following a guilty plea does not reflect accurately in any way the position of OH&S or LRWS. Okay? What I find surprising, I mean, not only the content of this, but this is not a flippant comment that the defense lawyers made. They pled guilty in January of this year. They've got a few months to think about this. They're going in for the sentencing hearing. Why would they say this? Why would they say such a thing? They've had time to think about it. Why would you say something like this? So the outcome of the sentencing hearing was a $200,000 fine. The maximum at the time when this incident occurred under legislation was $300,000. Now our maximum is $1.5 million in Saskatchewan. There was also an $80,000 victim surcharge. That's not the end of the legal activities for the 2011 explosion. The Regina Police Service Major Crimes Unit has had an investigation into the explosion. There's a provision in the criminal code that was put in place after the 1992 Westray explosion. There's, to best of my knowledge, still a civil lawsuit at the Court of Queen's Bench in Regina. The scaffolding company is suing the refinery for $2.9 million for damages. And there's also a lawsuit brought on by six injured workers who are want to be able to sue the co-op refinery for negligence under workers' compensation law. There's no fault system, and currently they can't challenge that, but they're challenging. They can't sue the employer directly, but they're challenging in court for the ability to sue the co-op refinery. The lawyer for the injured workers said, we asked the Regina Police Service to investigate based on specific flaws that we saw in the OH&S investigation from information we had at the time. We provided them with a list of people to talk to who were not interviewed by OH&S or any other party after the explosion. What I was told by the lawyer was that OH&S didn't interview people that gave victim impact statements. So the information that Shana shared earlier was not gathered by OH&S. Okay. Mike Carr said the work, and I'll leave this here for everybody to read, but in the interest of time, I'll just focus on this. In this regard, the work of the OH&S investigative team was extensive, detailed, and exhaustive. Okay, so two views there, but this was the grounds for asking the chief of police to have another look at this, and that's ongoing. I couldn't tell you the status of it now. So last point on the 2011 explosion, what does justice look like for the workers injured in 2011? The response from the lawyer. He says, they want to see specific people, some of whom they know by name, who likely contributed to it, publicly named, and they want to see accountability going up in that company as high as it should go. Moving forward to, and it's going to get much quicker, we'll get through these things quite quickly now. There was an incident in 2012, a fire, $5 million damage, just a fire in the pump house. February 11th, 2013, there's a fire in the coker pump house, and it's extinguished shortly after it begins. Cost $2.5 million. And Shana, you're going to read a description. Yeah.
Leslie Albert was driving down the ring road when she noticed the glow from the refinery was brighter than usual. She quickly realized, oh my God, it's on fire. The flames were going straight up in the air, she said, adding that they were shooting up higher than the buildings. Pulling over to capture the scene in pictures, Albert, thinking back to a major blaze there in October 2011, thought, another fire? Truck driver Gord Thompson also saw the site from the ring road. It was just a black cloud and it just burst into a big ball of flame, he said, adding that there was a sound like the low rumble of a freight train. It was like a flare-up, and then it finally caught a flame and turned into a fireball, he added. It was pretty scary.
This is a pretty major incident. The with Federated Co-op responds, tells the Leader Post, we had one of the best safety records in regard to fires like this in the industry. He added that it's believed the recent incidents, all of which are unrelated, are, quote, an anomaly. This is not the norm for us or for anyone else. Really interesting quote here from CGME on the day of the fire. And this is striking to me because it seems to contradict what the injured workers and others were saying of the 2011 explosion. Heward concedes that their safety record used to be among the best in the industry, but he admits he can't say that now. When asked if employees have any reason to fear for their safety, Heward said there wasn't a single employee registered any major safety concerns or left the company because of them. That's a disjoint there. Several people say they brought concerns forward, and one of the organizational leaders at Federated Co-op saying, we haven't heard anything. Goes on to say, one fire is too many, as we said before, but these are relatively minor fires in a complex of this scope. But again, are we disappointed? Absolutely, we're disappointed. Are we concerned? Yes, we are. And are we working very hard to fix it? Yes, we are. Okay? So we're going to have a deep dive. We're working very hard to fix these problems. Okay? That's the commitment. That's the public statements there. All right? So moving forward, later in 2013, we've got a leak here. A plume of oil leaking from a leaky valve. It dissipates, moves 700 meters away from the refinery and lands on some cars. And then moving forward a few days later to the Christmas Eve explosion, December 24th. We don't have a video of this incident. Fire occurred. How many people remember the explosion here? Okay, quite a few people in the room. 3:25 p.m., fire extinguished by 9 p.m. There's four explosions and a massive fireball, plumes of thick black smoke heard far away from Regina, and the cost estimated by the refinery is $77 million for this. And Shana will read some eyewitness accounts of this here.
There are three short ones here. First is, I thought someone had hit our house. That's how hard the explosion was, said Brenda McLeish. She lives in Glencairn, just a 5-minute drive from the refinery complex. You physically could feel the shaking and everyone's running into the streets and going, oh my God, what's going on? So it's a complete different thing from the last one. Second one, we live in the cathedral area and we felt and heard the blast. It sounded like a car hit our house. And three, I was also on site on October 2011 when the first major incident occurred. And after the last few incidents the past few years, I will never be working at this site again, ever.
So public officials speak out about this. It's Christmas Eve. And so the Prime Minister says, you know, tweets, glad to hear everybody's okay. Please be safe, EMS crews. The Premier says, praying for everyone at the refinery. Hope all are safe. Our Mayor Fougere says, in a quote from CJME, obviously this is an accident, but it's incumbent upon the Federated Co-op to determine that cause and make sure it runs safely. The more that happens, the more concerned you become. I'm not saying I'm not concerned. I'm saying that I'm very hopeful and confident that the refinery will find the source of the problem, fix it, and make sure it doesn't happen again. I would just flag the comment, obviously this is an accident. This is not an accident. This was a preventable incident according to the independent third-party investigation. Here. The officials for the refinery and Federated Co-op reply, one is one too many. We've had a number. It's a serious concern for us at this point in time. Mr. Heward says, we work very, very hard on our systems, but clearly we need to be better. It's another major incident here. And then a year later, just about a year ago, actually, after the investigation report comes out, Heward says, we believe every incident is preventable, and we wish we would have prevented this. So here's a picture taken from the investigation report of where it occurred. This was a skeleton team crew on site because of Christmas Eve. We could have had fatalities here if there was there were more people present. There would be a greater risk for that. There's a joint investigation by Regina Fire and Service and Technical Safety Authority of Saskatchewan. They issued a report in October 2014. It's available online. The root cause was water froze and ruptured a bypass line in the
polymerization.
Thank you. Unit 27. As the water in the bypass line thawed, hydrocarbons leaked from the ruptured portion of the line and ignited. Here's a picture from the TSAS report of pointing out where the bypass line was. They have 10 recommendations in their report. I think they're damning. I really do. Given all the talk before about do a deep dive, we're working really hard on things. We're working with outside consultants. Recommendation number 2, procedures for incident investigation should be revised to ensure that corrections are implemented so that incidents do not repeat. A similar pipe rupture due to freezing occurred in December 2008, where the resulting vapor cloud did not ignite. Effective corrective actions were not implemented. Recommendation number 9. The refinery should systematically identify where installed piping differs from design specifications. The differences should be analyzed and suitably addressed as necessary. To be clear, it's not a cause of the incident, but in the course of their investigation, they found that the bypass line was found to be Schedule 80. Well, the design document said it should be a Schedule 120, or 160, pardon me. Schedule 80 has a wall thickness of 0.218, whereas 160 has 0.34. So we've got a problem with the pipes again, okay? Again, not, to be clear, not a cause of the incident, but they flag it. They flag it in there. They're saying, look, this has occurred. Corrosion as well, they flag this. Recommendation number 10. The refinery should revise its corrosion survey procedures to assess corrosion under insulation on jacketed and insulated components. The corrosion survey procedure should utilize methods to identify and assess areas where corrosion is the greatest. Again, I want to emphasize, although not the cause of this incident, significant exterior corrosion was found on the bypass line. It was jacketed and insulated. Okay, and I mean, this was back in 2011. This was flagged, you know, as an issue here. Data from thickness monitoring locations on the bypass line did not detect the exterior corrosion that was found. And we had problems back in 2011, according to the independent report, about the thickness monitoring locations with the data, okay? So 2 years and a bit later, we still, these sorts of issues still seem to be present. One very quick footnote on this. At just days before the explosion, the Regina City Council approved the Somerset development, and I just have to flag this. There's, you know, Evraz is up there, Somerset's going to sit around here, and then the refinery's there. The development will be the home for up to 3,200 people. It was opposed by the Regina Capel Health Region. It was opposed, I think, quite forcefully by the refinery management. In 2013, they said, the refinery believes the city should not allow residential development in this area of Regina and establish a reasonably large setback for residential developments from industrial facilities. After the approval, the refinery says, we raised our concerns with the city several years ago. We thought it was an ill-advised decision, but the city came to its conclusion. The Ministry of Environment, we don't think this is a good idea. We oppose this idea here. And the mayor says, well, people will know when they buy the land, if they decide to buy a home there. They'll know the refinery is there. You know, the refinery has grown dramatically over years, okay? Like when Uplands was put in there, I mean, it was a much smaller facility, okay? And you can't guarantee that the management of the refinery or EVRES, for that matter, any large industrial complex, there won't be some lapse in the priority that they put on safety somewhere down the line. You cannot guarantee that. It's impossible. So I don't know. I don't know the logic behind this decision, but the Regina Capel Health Region Environment and the refinery put it best, I'll put it that way. Moving forward, so we have a leak in November 20th, 2014. There's a partial evacuation of the site. I think it's the day of the sentencing hearing for the 2011 explosion, there's a fire at the refinery, small one. Quickly extinguished. It's a small fire, okay? 240. I don't have any details. There's nothing reported in any media. I couldn't get any more information on it. And then most recently in September of this year, a leak detected, a fairly large evacuation. I want to pick up on this thing that how the co-op discusses safety and its public relations around safety. And this quote, I think, touches on that. It's a report, and I don't have the source here. It's a Leader Post article. When asked about the refinery's track record, Delore, this is the director of communications, repeated a line he delivered in November 2014 when the facility experienced another minor leak. Quote, obviously the refinery is a complex facility with complexity comes challenges, he said. We are confident that we have the necessary procedures in place to detect these leaks and isolate the areas, because the number one priority is safety of our people and our neighbors. Before I get to my summary conclusions, I want to touch briefly on fatalities at the refinery. This information just came to me from the lawyer for the injured workers just a couple weeks ago, and I've just haven't had a lot of time to work on it, but I do want to flag it here. First, I want to mention this, and maybe I should have done it at the outset of my presentation. You might be surprised, given all the talk about danger, explosions, and that, you might think that the injury rate is quite high at a refinery. Well, it's not. It's not. The total injury rate, so this is the percentage of workers in Saskatchewan in a given year that would have a lost time injury or a non-lost time injury, is 8.3%. So about 8 out of 100 people experience an injury overall in Saskatchewan. For this Workers' Compensation Board rate code, the refinery is an upgrader, 4.57. So the injury rate is actually lower in refining, okay? The issue with refining is you get catastrophic events, right? Like Texas City, right? That can take a number of lives all at once. So given that the injury rate is lower and given that there's been no fatalities with the explosions, I was surprised to see that this number of fatalities since 2000. And there's been 5 of them. And the information comes from the WCB. It was an access to information request. And one in 2003, 6, 7, 12, and 14. They've all been classified as occupational disease. There's 2 classifications for fatality. Occupational disease, where exposure can come, if it's asbestos, could be decades before you pass away. or injury related to a traumatic event. That's the second category of fatality. But all these are categorized as occupational disease. What's interesting is there's 3 days in between the reported date of the injury and death in the 2003, 5 months for the 07, and 7 weeks for the 2014 one. So I think we need more information to interpret the data about the types of occupational disease, about the original date of exposure and the date of reporting the disease to the WCB. However, when you look at the number of fatalities we've had in Saskatchewan, 2000 to 2014, we've had 512. I estimate about 189 of them are related to occupational disease. The refinery has five of them. Five out of 189. It's 2.7% by my calculation. And I've got a whole bunch of notes you can see here about this. Need more information. Very important to get more information. And I'm happy to share my calculations on this here, but I wouldn't present this if I didn't feel confident in the estimations here. So 2.7 of the fatalities related to occupational disease occurred at the refinery site. So the question is then what percentage of the workforce does the refinery employ on average? And, you know, I've averaged from 2014, if they had 850 employees on average per year, that'd be 2.3% of the workforce in Saskatchewan. If there was 2,000 on average per year, it'd be 0.5%. So it's overrepresented, the number of fatalities there. I don't know why, but it's overrepresented. 2.7% of occupational disease fatalities, and their workforce is a quarter to half percent of workforce in things. So something that warrants further study and perhaps questions to the refinery to provide some more detail about this. So in summary, the safety record between the 10-year period I've looked at, two fatalities, 52 injured workers in the 2011 explosion, two explosions, three fires, three fairly significant leaks. Total reported cost of the incidents is $184 million. That's the refinery's cost. I'm sure it's much, much higher than that in terms of lost productivity, but that's what's been reported. Legal cases, still not resolved altogether. Damage to the corporate reputation. Underlying causes of the incidents at the refinery. Here's sort of my summation of what I'm seeing based on my analysis of the safety culture at the refinery. Seems to be poor management of change during periods of expansion. We see this in the 80s with the upgrader, 2011. Where was the attention at the time? Was the attention on Section 5? Or was too much attention there and not enough on the existing older infrastructure? Inadequate monitoring and inadequate uneven implementation of processes. It's noted in the independent reports. Even in the industry, Canadian Association of Fuels Association, they note it, that there's things that the refinery could be doing differently. Lack of learning from past near misses and incidents, noted in the reports. There's a gap in the words of the top leaders in the organization and the experience on the front lines. Seems to be a somewhat of a lack of understanding the scope of the safety problems at the refinery. They're in different sections of the refinery. But if you got problems everywhere, you might have a problem with your culture, you know? Post-2011, you know, safety, there's lots of positive pronouncements about safety, and it's sort of a one-way, seems to be at times a one-way public relations strategy. Reluctance to talk to the media. They want to get their message out, which is fine, but there's real lack of transparency and two-way communication. This is surprising given that the refinery touts its cooperative values and working together with other people. Well, it's a two-way street. It's not just the refinery dictating the message they want out there. It's a two-way street. Potentially, the focus was too much on financial performance and potentially too much attention on Section 5 and cost overruns there. Came in $800 million over the original budget. What were the discussions at the time? Don't know. Leadership style at the top of the refinery. Hear rumors about that. I'm not about to repeat rumors here, but is that a potential cause? And what about the strength of the union there? You know, just have no insight into it. It spoke to Perry in Newfoundland. You know, he says, you know, they're pretty quiet in, you know, in public, but they're really tough, you know, tough with the management behind closed doors. Is the Unifor union tough with the management on safety in that? I don't know. I'm not going to speculate on it. But the evidence that I presented today and the my analysis of it, to me, there's systemic issues with the safety culture at the refinery. Whether they've been resolved in 2015, I don't know. But certainly in the past, there were issues there and a weak culture of safety. I'm going to move forward here. The refinery's been rebranded. You've got a new website now, came out this fall. Lots of advertising billboards around the city. You've seen those. New mission statement. Still say they're continuing to implement the new process safety management system and new leadership at the refinery. Some pictures from the website. Again, their vision is to be a recognized leader in safety. Stronger public commitment to safety? I don't know. I mean, they say, the head of the refinery now says if a process operator sees something that isn't safe or there's equipment malfunction, we, the managers, have to give them the authority to decide to shut down that part of the operation until we get it fixed. That's promising. Whether that's the practice, I don't know. I think this statement's interesting from last June. Over the last few years, we have put a lot of money into steel. I take this as the expansion and rapid growth. Now it's time to focus. Now it's time for us to focus, for us to increase our investment in our people and the systems that support those people. So is this some admission that the attention wasn't where it should have been before? I'm going to end here, and I really thank you for your time. This is an hour and a half. You sat patiently in the talk here, and we'll have a discussion soon. I just have a few unanswered questions I want to throw out here. I know there's some media in the room here, but these are some things that I think need to warrant follow-up. Are criminal charges warranted for the October 6, 2011 explosion? Regina Police Service is looking into this right now. I'm not a lawyer, and I'm gonna just say this, that I think it definitely warrants a close look. I think definitely you need to have another look at this and just see, you know, have another look where there, can they determine whether there was people at mid or senior levels that knew, and if they did, you know, you don't get a pass. Even if it's improved at the refinery, you don't get a pass because no individual gets a pass. You know, and the section 217.1 of the criminal code says everyone who undertakes or has the authority to direct how another person does work or performs a task is under a legal duty to take reasonable steps to prevent bodily harm to that person or any other person arising from that work or task. And other sections of the criminal code impose criminal liability on organizations and its representatives. I don't know. I'm not a lawyer, but I think it warrants another look. Going forward, how does the refinery show that it's genuinely committed to safety? You know, it's time to be proactive and be transparent with the media and community groups. No more of this sort of one-way communication. Here's what we think. We're going to control the message. We're not going to talk to journalists if they come to us. I mean, it's just not acceptable, I think. And I don't think it reflects on their cooperative values, which they tout, you know. They talk about the cooperative values. Here's some here. sufficient disclosure of information, right to safety. I mean, there's not time to go through this, but they say they're different. They say they're a cooperative organization. They say their values are important to them. You know, exercise the values, okay? The fatalities, three fatalities with the short gaps between injury and death, have, as LRWS investigated these incidents. Again, I don't want to speculate. I would need more information about those fatalities, but it does strike me as a bit odd. Where is the refinery at with the leak detection program? Why did it take so long after the 2012 report? Just some follow-up on these reports. Have they followed through on all the recommendations? Is the refinery still engaged with outside consulting organizations? I don't know how many times I hear that we're working with DuPont. That doesn't really answer the question. Why do these incidents occur? Don't hide behind DuPont. Tell us what you're doing. Bring in the media for a PowerPoint presentation that explains how much you've spent on safety, how many people you've hired, and what you're doing exactly. Don't wait for another incident and then have the media come to you. And don't hide behind DuPont anymore. It's shameful. They should share more and more specific information with the media and community members. They should be open with the media. They say, you know, we don't allow media on to our site for tours because it's not safe. Well, fine, fair enough. That's fair. But you had an open house when you opened up Section 5, you brought the media in for a tour. And Mayor Fugere, I've got a quote from the Leader Post, I think it's 09, where he says, and council's invited to go see the facility. You can't have it all on your own terms. Jeff, you're here. Jeff Leo's here, sitting in the front row. Jeff is working on getting the release of a major hazards, not a RIC report, a risk assessment report. And the city says it released it, the Ministry of Environment said it released it. And the Privacy Commissioner says it should be released. With some redactions, right? Minor redactions?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the refinery's fighting this. They're appealing the Privacy Commissioner's decision. You know, question, you know, was the executive for Unifor Local 594 interviewed by Labor Relations Workplace Safety in the investigation 2011 explosion and the 2013? I mean, are they part of this investigation process? I mean, they would have the interest that the workers at the fore, they might have information about the culture of the organization. Is the union adequately represented on the refinery incident investigation team? It's a question that Perry at the Come By Chance refinery asked me to ask. I don't know the answer to it. A big unanswered question here is there a community liaison committee that meets with the refinery management at regular intervals, like say every month, to discuss safety, environmental change management issues at the refinery? Perry said, you know, this is what we have at the refinery, and Come By Chance, management's there, the union's there, and there's community representatives there, and they meet and they can ask questions. I don't know whether it's in camera or not, but I don't think we have this in Regina. And I think we're going to have the fourth largest refinery in Canada, and I think we should have one. Because otherwise, you know, they're going to control the message of the refinery, and people won't know what's going on. So I think if there's one thing that I think is important that comes out of all of this, is that we have more transparency and accountability in the community. I think that would be fantastic. What form that takes, I don't know. There's lots of different forms, but other refineries have done that, and surely with a cooperative refinery, we could do that. Surely we could do that. Just point 11 here, the provincial government, can they hire more inspectors? This is a theme picked up from Emily Eaton's talk on oil extraction. You know, there's a need. The OH&S division, Ministry of Environment, can we do more funding there for those things? And I will leave it there, because that's been very patient, and I'll just leave it there. Thanks for your patience, and we'll just turn off recorders, the video recorder now, and we'll do Q&A.